Good afternoon, everybody. And at the outset, I'd like to thank Dr. Digvijay for giving me this opportunity to present in this instruction course. Also, I am thankful to AIOS for this topic, which is very interesting to see the vision loss with normal funders. I do not have any financial or commercial interest in any of this material discussed in this presentation. This is purely an academic one. Now we see the mind and eye connection. The poor vision normal funders, what are the causes? The mind should know before the eye sees. So now we should always see this dictum: when you hear hoof beats, what you expect? Horse or zebra? Horse is for common diseases, and zebra would have been a rare disease. Now, what are the common things that we see? For example, with normal eye movement in children, there may be refractive error or amblyopia that can give rise to a low vision with normal fundus. As Swati mentioned, non-organic visual loss such as malingering sometimes can pose problems. And one very important thing is delayed visual maturation, where vision improved to normal by 6 months, where the child can present in this situation. Early retinal dystrophies such as cone dystrophy or Stargardt can present in this scenario, and cortical visual impairment sometimes can present like this. And in adult, as some of my previous speaker has shown, retrovulvar neuritis with all imaging and other visual field changes, nutritional amblyopia, and the paraneoplastic disease, either associated retinopathy or melanoma associated retinopathy, can pose a low vision with normal fundus. In children with abnormal eye movement, a different scenario, where lever congenital amaurosis can present, you have a clinical sign, for example, eye poking, then rotatory eye movement, etc., nystagmus, then achromatopsia can pose this problem. X-ray recessive congenital stationary blindness sometimes can pose this. So to go about investing in these cases, let us take a case scenario. A 28-year-old lady with a sudden loss of vision in the right eye. Now she had a ocular movement while in she has an eye pain in the right eye, and there was when eliciting the ocular movement there was pain mostly in the retrovulvar area, the boring pain she felt. Vision was 624 and 18 in the right eye. Left eye was normal. There was relative afferent pupillary defect, and impairment of visual color vision was seen in the right eye by Ishiar and FM100 test. There was diminished contrast sensitivity, as Dr. Sheena has shown in his slide by Spelli-Robson chart, was seen in our institution. Visual field defect was centrosecal, as shown in the figure here. Now, obviously, our diagnosis, we want to rule out retrovulvar neuritis, and MRI was given, as Rohit showed in his wonderful pictures of MRI. Here, multiple hyperintense lesion, periventricular lesion was seen along with thickening of the optic nerve. So this is a case of a retrovulvar neuritis. And you see in our undergraduate classes, it was told, the dictum was told that in retrovulvar neuritis, that, the patient does not see anything, doctor does not see anything. So this is a wonderful examination. And in BAP, as Swati showed, there was a minimal amplitude changes, but there's prolonged latency. Now, important thing is that the pattern BAP can be useful to show the delayed response. There is also some center in abroad, they have a multifocal BAP also in a new armamentarium of electrophysiological test. Now, OCT, if you see, it is, and this was in the follow-up of the case, and so that red zone, what Dr. Rashmin showed, was not entitled, but you can see the yellow zone touching the black one. So here, important thing, as Dr. Rashmin has mentioned, that retinal nerve fiber analysis along with GCL, IPL change, which is more sensitive. Okay, an important thing for retrovulvar neuritis is more for a myelin oligodendrocyte glycoma made MOG optic neuropathy. Sometimes there may be you need to investigate more in atypical optic neuropathy, okay, with all these collagen and other diseases. Neurologists sometimes do a CSF analysis for this oligoclonal band. And apart from the, as Dr. Rashmin has shown that there may be other, and Dr. Sheena has shown the aquaporin for a NMO spectrum disease sometimes can be helpful. But here is one important one. If you're suspecting a Leber's heredity optic neuropathy, it is usually young male, maternally related male, bilateral, and vision recovery is very less comparative to optic neuritis, where genetic counseling and other testing are helpful. So few tips about the OCT is that the retinal nerve fiber layer thinning in ethambutol or linozolid like antibiotic toxic optic neuritis, OCT can helpful in early toxicity and quantify the loss of retinal nerve fiber. In Leber's congenital amaurosis or early onset retinal dystrophy, retinal thinning can be seen. Fundus, LV punctus, and particularly for Okuchi's disease, which is a congenital special night blindness, but accumulation of rhodopsin in the rod outer segment can be an important finding. And in achromatopsia, the ISOS junction and outer nuclear layer, as well as flattened foveal contour can be an important tip. The second case already some of the instructor has shown that in what happened in TB cases with ethambutol. This is a 33-year-old man with pulmonary TB, was on ATT for 2 months. The INH rifampicin, pyrazinamide, and ethambutol was given. Now, the person developed dimness of vision by 5 weeks after starting of ATT. Vision was 6, 12, and 18, almost symmetrical in both the eye. And you see there's a normal fundus and the low vision. Now, the color vision defect was seen along with 100U test. The important thing, Dr. Sina has mentioned in the first presentation, that for toxic neuropathy, is usually blue-yellow to start with, but for optic neuritis, it is usually red-green or mixed pattern, because in blue-yellow, because the drug affects the foveal part first. And this patient in multifocal ERG has reduced response in the mass response in the right eye and left eye, there's a basic trace defect was noted. So in clinical part for toxic amblyopia, proper history is very, very important. Systemic medication, substance abuse, alcohol and smoking can add the problem. Associated metabolic disease such as kidney disease can accelerate the problem of toxic optic neuropathy. Familial history of hereditary optic neuropathy is very, very important because they can sum up the condition very close. And history of headache and vertigo is important. What usually we miss in the investigation for toxic neuropathy is the blood culture for the toxin and urine analysis for specific toxin, heavy metal screening. And if you see bilateral involvement, it is better to see the serum vitamin and folate acids. Now, case three is very, very interesting. 62-year-old lady, visual loss in right eye 6-12 and 12, left eye 6-9. So bilateral dimness of vision, but very peculiar problem she complained was episode of darkness and feeling of strands in the visual field, which lasts for minutes to hours. There was a defective visual color vision. Fundus was within normal limit. Okay, but there was a history of endometrial carcinoma 11 years back. 3 years back, she has done a PET CT, a whole body where abdominal PET CT showed para-aortic node 3 months, but recent PET scan was normal. Now you see there's a negative waveform in ERG where there's a prolonged latency, but few changes were in the amplitude. The MI was normal. Here you see the OCT. Here the OCT showed sensorineural detachment, but very carefully you observe the RP layer. There's undulation of the RP, which can tell you that there may be an antibody or a metastatic-like lesion can happen, like a carcinoma-associated retinopathy, where the autoimmune mechanism can happen that does not present as a metastatic as such, but onto antibody reaction can happen there. So few tips for CAR is that visual symptom may precede the signs of systemic malignancy by 3 to 12 months or so. no gender predilection, see mainly in the elderly, decreased visual acuity, color vision defect, paracentral scotoma in the visual field, impaired dark adaptation, complete workout for the metastasis, very, very important. Here is the important tool, now what Swati showed and electrophysiological presentation. Here, ERG may have a high, maybe advantageous role more than OCT in detecting the early changes and circulating antibodies such as enolase and recombinase can be important finding. Now, some additional important tests for this fundus autofluorescence, the neuro-ophthalmologist do not do, but the retinal specialist do this test often. In some cases of X-linked congenital station and night blindness, typically demonstrate decreased background autofluorescence, which is consistent with the dysfunctional retinal cycle. I have seen some of the paper in the advanced center where microperimetry is used to detect the what you call multiple sclerosis, the retinal mapping, particularly in the macula, is very, very helpful. But most of the center in India do not have microperimetry to add in the diagnosis of neuro-ophthalmology. For LCA and early onset retinal dystrophy, genetic and molecular testing, I've already said, is very, very important. So the take-home message is basic investigations are very, very important. As Professor Sina told in his presentation, role of color vision, visual field, newer generation of OCT, such as HROCT, multifocal ERG, aid in various diagnosis of reduced vision and normal fundus. Investigation should be case-based or tailor-based. Thank you for patient hearing.